As we come to our series today in the book of Proverbs, we've been dealing with questions that have been in the hearts of not only God's people, but questions that have been in the hearts of individuals. And today we come in the book of Proverbs to deal with this issue: how do I build and maintain healthy relationships? How do I build and maintain healthy relationships? So maybe there's somebody that's not here today, or somebody that you know, and we pray that you would take the notes, and if the Lord so moves you to get a copy of this message, that you would get a copy of the message and share it with those individuals. But you might have to do it on the sly, right? Because if you just outright boldly give it to them, they might say, hey, what you doing? And they might think that you're trying to get a message across to them, which you are. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to proclaim your word. And we ask now as we come, Lord, that you would just enrich your word in our hearts so that we might be obedient servants of the Most High God. Father, we just ask that you would minister to us, and when we leave this place, through us. And Lord, that you would help us, Lord, to not only deal with issues in our own lives, Lord, but that we would be able to share with others as we come in contact with them. As we open up your word today, we invite the congregation to come and dine. The master's calling, come and dine. You can feast at Jesus' table anytime. He who fed the multitudes and turned the water into wine, come and dine. The master's calling, come and dine. Feed us, Lord, at your table. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You know, sometimes relationships can be crazy. I was reading something, and it says, if you think your family has problems, consider the marriage mayhem created when 76-year-old Bill Baker of London recently wed Edna Harvey. She happened to be his granddaughter's husband's mother. That's where the confusion began. According to Baker's granddaughter, Lynn, my mother-in-law is now my step-grandmother. My grandfather is now my step-father-in-law. My mom is my sister-in-law, and my brother is my nephew. But even crazier is now that I'm married to my uncle, and my own children are my cousins. So sometimes relationships can be crazy. But as we look at the message this morning, I want to ask you the question as we go to our next slide, and that is, do you know or recognize any of the people up here? Now, I know this is not the clearest slide, and I knew that when it was going to go up there, but, you know, either there are people that we know who fit into these personality types, or, sad to say, that we ourselves might be one of these personality types. And what we need to understand that as we deal with relationships, you know, these are the types that we will be dealing with. And so when we deal with personality types, there's the know-it-alls. And let me see, it might be better for me if I read it off of my notes up here. The know-it-all. They are arrogant and usually have an opinion on every issue. And when they are wrong, they get defensive. So all of us probably know somebody that's close to us, whether, like it says at the bottom, at the top it says, do you recognize these people? And it says at the bottom, of course you recognize them. They are people you work with, sell to, depend on, and live with. All right, I heard you. Somebody said, well. So, you know, we all know-it-alls. They think they know everything. And you know, the one thing about know-it-alls is even when you have a story, they always have a better story. you know, something that more spectacular happened to them. All right. And then there are the passives. These people never offer ideas or let you know where they stand. You know, they just kind of are incognito, and really nobody understands, you know, where they're at, where they're coming from. And then all of us are exposed to the dictators. They bully and intimidate. They're constantly demanding and brutally critical, just critical of everything that comes down the pike. You know, they find something wrong. No matter how perfect something is, that not only do they bully, but they can find something wrong with the thing that's being put up front. Then there are the yes people, and they agree to any commitment, yet rarely deliver. You can't trust them to follow through, that they make commitments that they don't follow through on. And then there are the no people. They are quick to point out why something won't work. And what's worse, they are inflexible. And then we see that there are the gripers. Is anything ever right with them? They prefer complaining to finding solutions. And so when we look at these personality types right here, and you know, it's interesting because as a pastor, you know, I have the opportunity to sit in a lot of meetings here at Bethany Baptist Church. And at some point in time, you know, you see these personality types coming out. Now, I'm not sitting down at the table evaluating and as we sit in a meeting to say, okay, this person is that, this person is that, this person. You know, no. But you know what? Sometimes, because it's so ingrained in the spirit of a person, that it just comes out. And so, you know, we need to ask ourselves, you know, we know that as we deal with these individuals in relationship, that, you know, we need to have wisdom. And that's what the whole message today is going to be talking about. I'm not necessarily going to be addressing situations within marriages, even though the principles that I give you will apply to marriages or families or any particular situation. But we're going to talk about relationships in general and how we can have and maintain healthy relationships. But like I said, maybe the more frightening thing, and I just like for you to think for a moment, you know, because it's easy, even when I was going through this, it's very easy for you to start thinking about people in your life that fall into these categories. But sometimes, you know, we got to say, it's not my mother, it's not my father, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the place of one of these people. All right? So, let's be honest. You ask yourself before we even move on. You know, because, you know, we need to make the message personal today. You know, again, I find that, you know, a lot of people, when they come to church, it's easy to put up your spiritual umbrella, right? When the word is going forth, you put up your umbrella, and when the bricks of the word fall, it bounces off of your umbrella and hits the people around you. So take down your spiritual umbrella today. Let the Lord minister to your spirit. Now, if you're going to be in relationship, you know, there are some characteristics that need to be true of your life. And when we think about that, we see that Proverbs 17:17 says, a friend loveth at all times. So if you are in a relationship, then you are a friend of the person that you're in the relationship with. And there ought to just be some general characteristics that that are part of your life, you know, whether you're in a marriage, whether, you know, it's a sibling situation, whatever the case might be. You know, these are some things that if you're in relationship, they ought to be true of your life. And so you got to ask yourself, you know, Am I a loving person? Am I a loving person? Am I an honest person? Am I a person that's trustworthy? You know, or you know, the people that I'm in relationship with, do they have reason to not trust me? You know, am I a person of integrity? Am I respectful? You know, do I respect other people's ideas, opinions, You know, I mean, you know, sometimes, you know, people can be so critical and they just dismiss whatever the other person is thinking, and they are not respectful of, you know, what that person might be thinking, their point of view. Don't try to understand it, you know, but just come off because, you know, things are all about them. It's all centered around them. Loyal, that's another characteristic of a person who's a friend. You know, that somebody that's dedicated, you know, somebody that's loyal to you, that got your back, that if you're doing something, that they'll come alongside and try to, you know, help you out. You know, serving, giving is a part of this. Patient. You know, when you go back and you read 1 Corinthians 13, where it talks about love, you know, one of the things that it talks about, love is patient. And so if you're in a relationship, you got to be patient with individuals. You know, you can't have a short fuse. You know, you can't go off the handle the minute that this person does the slightest thing that's wrong. You gotta have some patience in relationships. You gotta be flexible. You know, some people are so rigid that it's their way or the highway. You know, there's no wiggle room. That if you don't fit in to this tight little box that I have, then, you know, we're gonna have conflicts. That our relationship is gonna have some struggles. And the reason, because you're not flexible. And, you know, you got to be flexible. And if you're going to be in relationship with somebody, you got to be forgiving. You know, I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. But you got to have a forgiving spirit. If you're a person that holds grudges and, you know, can't let things go, then it's going to be very difficult to be in a relationship. Because sooner or later, somebody's going to do something that's going to be an offense. And, you know, you're going to have to deal with it and let it go. And then support it. You know, that when, and I like the verse that we have here. Now, again, it says a friend loveth at all times. A friend loveth at all times, you know, and that love means they're honest, respectful, loyal, serving, patient, flexible, forgiving, and especially the second part of that verse, that when adversity comes, that your friend is supportive. Now, I saw this, and I just threw it up here to put it up here. On getting along with other people. And so I said, well, let me throw this in here. So we, you know, y'all don't have to give anything in the offering for this. This is free. All right. Six most important words. I made a mistake. The five most important words. You did a good job. The four most important words. What do you think? The three most important words, after you please. The two most important words, thank you. The one most important word, we. And the least important word is I. But sad to say that the least important word, oftentimes, is the most important word. You know, you heard the poem that I like to tell. I had a little tea party this afternoon at 3. It was very small, 3 guests in all, just I, myself, and me. I ate all the sandwiches while I drank all the tea. It was also I that ate the pie, now pass the cake to me. You know, so that's the testimony of the average person. You know, it's all about them. You know, the party is all about them. But when you're in a relationship, the party cannot be all about you. And so that's what we're going to discover today in the book of Proverbs. Now, one of the most important things before I actually get into the verses today that I have to say, because I said it in my book, Mending the Fences or Rebuilding the Fences of Broken Relationships, that one of the most important things that has to be a part of a relationship is brokenness. Is brokenness. What is brokenness? Brokenness is yielding, you know, yourself, yielding your rights to the rights of those around you when you are in relationships. And if you don't have an attitude or a spirit of brokenness, I'm just going to say it's going to be very difficult for you to function in a healthy manner within relationships. That you have to, as Paul said, I am crucified. Oh, hallelujah. I am crucified with Christ, yet I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That's brokenness right there. That's brokenness right there. That you yield, you know, first of all, to God. that you yield to his plan, you yield to his program, and in yielding to God's plan and program, sometimes there's a call to yield to those around us. And so brokenness is the key. So let's get into the lesson today, and we'll start by looking at the notes. How do I build and maintain healthy relationships? The first one is to show a genuine interest. Show a genuine interest. If you're in a relationship with another person, that you ought to be interested in them. You ought to be interested in what they're thinking, what they're, you know, what they're doing, you know, what their life is all about. Proverbs 20 and verse 5, it says this: counsel in the heart of a man is like deep water, but a man of understanding will draw it out. This verse means that a wise person is able to draw out the matters that are deep in the heart of another person. In relationships, it is seen when one friend shows a genuine interest in getting to know what's in the heart of the other person by spending time together and by asking profound questions about their life. So when I'm in relationship, I'm interested in what's going on in another person's life. And as I was studying this, I was looking at, you know, what are some key things that are part of relationships? And across the board, it almost said that, you know, you got to be interested in the other person. You got to want to know, you know, what's in their heart, what's in their spirit, you know, what's going on. You know, and I was thinking about this, and I said, well, you know, first of all, when you ask somebody how they're doing, and a lot of people say, well, I'm doing fine. And the reason they say that, most people are not doing fine. You know, there's usually something going on in the background of their life. But they figure one of two things. Either, you know, I don't want anybody to know that I'm going through it, or you're really not interested in what I'm going through. And then, you know, when somebody asks, hey, how are things going? You know, and let's be real. How many of us, when we ask that question, oh, we're going to get in trouble now. But how many of us, when we ask that question, let's be honest, really want to know? Really want to know, right? So that if a person opens up and they start telling you all this stuff that's going on, you're like, why did I ask that question? You know, but in relationship, you know, you can't be like that. There has to be that genuine interest that you have. And see, and so that means that a lot of a talk about me, myself, and I has to be put on the side. And if both people are doing that, then guess what? There's going to be some healthy communication. Why? Because we are both genuinely interested in what's going on in the other person's life. Generally, where communication breaks down is when it's all about one person. It's all about their problems, all about their issues. Then, you know, that means that the other person is not getting their equal opportunity to be able to share what's in their heart and on their spirit. So the first thing is that you have to show a genuine interest when you're in relationships. The second thing that we see is that you have to have nurture a forgiving spirit. Nurture a forgiving spirit. In the notes it says, those who are in healthy relationships are able to overlook the faults and wrongs of others. Proverbs 19, verse 11 says, the discretion of a man deferreth his anger, and it is his glory to pass over a transgression. Now, let me say this, because somebody could get the wrong idea. It doesn't mean that you overlook serious issues. It doesn't mean that you overlook when a person is irresponsible. It doesn't mean that you overlook it when a person is involved in some type of gross immoral sin. You know, that's not what it's talking about. But it says that when you nurture a forgiving spirit, what that means is that in the normal course of life, when you're in a relationship, whether it's in a family or with friends, that at some point somebody's going to do something that causes a little riffle, all right, a little ruffle, a little triffle. And when that happens, you know, you can't be, oh, man, you know what? And you know what? And you can't get all bent out of shape. You have to nurture a forgiving spirit. And when you nurture a forgiving spirit, then the first thing that you're going to realize, now again, notice what I said before. I'm not saying somebody that's, you know, that's blatantly immoral or somebody that is out to hurt you and wound you. That, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about in the normal course of a healthy relationship. When these little things happen, if you have nurtured a forgiving spirit, when they happen, what do you say? You realize, first of all, that this person is not intentionally trying to hurt me or wound me. Now, again, you know the difference, because I know some of y'all sitting there and you saying, yeah, well, you don't know. You don't know what happened to me. You don't know what I went through. That's why I'm saying, in the course of a normal, healthy relationship, that when two friends or two people in relationship, whenever something happens, that the person who has been offended, if they nurture a forgiving spirit, then it's not going to be something that they're going to harbor and they're going to keep deep down in their soul and bring it up at that precise time to hammer that person over the head. Why? Because you've nurtured a forgiving spirit, an accepting spirit. And if you're going to be in a relationship, you can't be in a relationship and not nurture a forgiving spirit. Because, you know, there's something that happens every day. You know, somebody's going to leave the toothpaste off the top off the toothpaste. Somebody's not going to put the toilet paper on the roll the way that you like it. All right. Somebody might get out of the shower and leave some water on the floor. Right. So, I mean, just those little things in the course of time can become very frustrating. But if you have if you nurture a forgiving spirit, then you deal with them. You know, you address them, but you don't harbor. You don't hold it. And so that's what people in relationships do. The third thing is meet their need for support. Meet their need for support. Most people have two emotional needs. I learned this years ago in counseling. And that is to love and to be loved. Those are the two, probably the most important emotional need. To love and to be loved. Now, wrapped up in those two is the need for support. Solomon informs us, a friend loveth at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. Proverbs 17:17. People in healthy relationships are there to provide encouragement in the good times and comfort in the times of adversity. So, when you are in relationship, that you need to realize that one of the functions of being in a relationship is to be here to support this other person. So again, even though I'm not addressing marriage, I'm not addressing family, I'm not addressing coworker, neighbors, these principles that I'm giving you work all the way across the board. That whenever, you know, somebody is hurting, then you are there for support. You know, don't be like the guy whose wife was hurting. And he took his wife, they went in to see a counselor. And they sat down and there was a lady that was counseling them. And, you know, after a while, she kind of figured out what the problem was. And so she asked the wife to stand up, and the wife stood up. And the lady counselor went over there and just, you know, held her for a moment. And it just seemed like the lady was able to just feel that support, and she kind of released all the tension and energy that was inside of her. And so the counselor turned to the husband, and he says, Now, your wife needs this every day. He said, okay. He said, I could bring her back every morning at 9 o'clock. don't be like that guy. I know that when my mom passed away, it was a blessing, just to have my wife and the support that she gave me, as we went through that, as we walked through that time together. And so all of us at some time are going to run into some difficult circumstances. And it's good to have somebody there that got your back. Somebody that's there to support you. Like the proverb says, a friend. What? A friend is born for adversity. When adversity comes, you know what your friends do? They roll their sleeves up and say, it's time for me to go to work. That's what friends do in the time of adversity. And that's why God has put us in relationship. When you look at the New Testament, you look at all those one another's. And you can't be one another by yourself. And so all those one another's are there so that we might encourage and that we might support one another. And so this is a basic principle for relationships. And that is, meet the other person's need for support, in the time of adversity. Make positive deposits in the relationship. Make positive deposits in the relationship. And by this, we mean in every relationship, there are positive and negative interactions. Now, this was amazing when I found this out. Statistics demonstrate when there are more positive than negative interactions, the relationship tends to be healthy. So let me read that again, because I don't want anybody to miss that. Statistics. Now, again, this is not the Bible, but this is the people that, sit down and figure these things out. Statistics demonstrate when there are more positive than negative interactions, the relationship tends to be healthy. One way to make positive deposits in relationships is to be an encourager. Proverbs 12:25. Heaviness in the heart of a man maketh it stoop, but a good word maketh it glad. People naturally feel good when they are encouraged. And just think how easy it is to encourage another person. It doesn't take a whole lot. You don't have to have a PhD. You don't have to go out and work 40 hours a week and to say something encouraging. And just think, when you are encouraging, what are you doing? You are making deposits that's building a healthy relationship. But if there's never any I love you, or I appreciate you, I appreciate what you do, that this is what this meant to me, if those encouragement words of encouragement are not being deposited, guess what? The relationship is going to struggle. It's going to struggle. And just think, people who we are in relationship with, just think for a moment, do you have more positive interaction or more negative interaction? Some people, they might be in our family, they might be on our job. It seems like we are in conflict all the time. There's constantly negative interaction. And I guarantee you, when that's the case, there's probably not a healthy relationship there. And so we need to realize that we need to be in the business of creating more positive interactions than we do negative interactions. Because if we are just in a bunch of negativity, then the chances are, I put it up there, one of the people that the personality types is a negative person, and most folk don't want to be around a negative person. I You remember that cartoon? Some of y'all might not remember this, but I remember it. The Flintstones, right? Fred Flintstone. Remember there was a guy, George probably, because I know George is a buff. He's a goes back. But there was a character on there that everywhere he walked, there was a cloud over his head, and it was just rain. It rained wherever he was going. It was raining. George, you remember that guy's name? What was his name? Bad Luck Sleprock. That's right. That's right. That's right. I knew you knew. And if you didn't know, I was going back to your brother because I know he might. But this guy, everywhere he went, there was a cloud over his head and it was raining. And you know, how many people, you know, are running to be around an individual like that? Nobody's running toward that individual. And so, you know, that's why, you know, we need to be positive people. You know, we need to be on a positive note because, you know, just to be around all that negativity is draining. To be around all that negativity, you a downer, man. You just bring me down. But when we are around encouragement, people feed on encouragement. You know, the kids feed on encouragement. You know, it's just amazing, you know, to see how much kids, you know, when you encourage them, it's almost like saying, sick them to a bulldog, you know, because they just get fired up and they're ready to go. So we need to make positive deposits in relationships so that we are having more positive experiences than we are negative experiences. Acquire healthy communication and conflict resolution skills. Now, I'm going to go through this. I'm not going to spend a lot of time here because we have the scriptures that are written in your notes. But first, be a good listener. Be a good listener. He that answers a matter before he heareth it, it is a folly and shame unto him. Proverbs 18:13. So if I'm talking and you're trying to talk, then that means neither one of us are listening. Right? If I'm talking, if I'm talking, and then as soon as I get finished talking, you unload everything that's in your spirit, then you know what that tells me? You weren't listening. You weren't listening. Now, I would say, we can get to your stuff, right? But listen. And so be people in relationship. You have to develop good listening skills. Now, you know, I can't get into everything in this message, but you could go online and type in listening skills. You can Google or Yahoo listening skills, and it will tell you, give you some good listening skills. But if you're going to be real, you need to have good listening skills. The next thing that we see is you got to be open to hear the hard things. If you're in a relationship, you know, you got to be open to hear the hard things. You know, most people don't want to hear the hard things. You know, that's just the way that we're wired. When something hard has to be dealt with, we bristle up. We protect ourselves. And we put up our shield because we don't want to hear it. But Proverbs 27 and verse 6 says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. That when somebody that loves you, somebody that cares for you, somebody that got your back, see, that's why, you know, and I know a lot of us in here, you know, we have it together, and, you know, we got it going on, and sometimes when we talk to people outside of here, maybe family members, or co-workers, you know, and we're trying, I said that facetiously now, okay, so, all right. But we should, to some degree, have it together. But just say that you're dealing with somebody in your family that's an alcoholic, or they're dealing with drugs, and you got to say the hard things to them. And when you say the hard things, it's not because you're trying to be mean, and it's not because you're trying to be nasty, but you're saying the hard things because you love them. Because you love them. And and you might bring wounds. And so a lot of times, and we need to be ready for this, what do? They shut you off. They shut you off. Here you go again. That's why I don't come around you. Here you go talking about that again, right? But you're not saying that because you're mean, and you're not saying that because you're trying to tear them down and belittle them and grind them to powder. That's not why you're doing it. You're doing it faithful are the wounds of a friend. So if we look at that situation with people who are in that lifestyle, and we know how we feel when they reject us, how do you think somebody that loves you, and it might not be drugs, it might not be alcohol, but they come and address you on something hard, then you, right, you get defensive, and then you get angry, and then you start fighting back. And here the scripture says that these wounds are there to help you. But we, we don't like to hear the hard things. I'll be honest with you, I don't like to hear the hard things. Really don't. And so, I think that's something, now I'm just going to say me, because maybe y'all got it together and y'all all right on this, so y'all just pray for your pastor, right? Because y'all got it together. But that when the hard issues have to be talked about and the hard issues have to be addressed, that the first thing, it's just like there's a viper down inside of us. And that as soon as that is brought up, that viper comes up like this. Keep on talking. Keep on talking. I've had just about enough. And we spray out that venom because it's hard. So, if we're in relationship, sometimes there has to be addressing the hard things. Next, be open to correction. The ear that heareth reproof, the reproof of life abideth among the wise. Be teachable. Have a teachable spirit. Be able to receive correction, receive instruction. Oh, this next one, have thick skin. Proverbs 27:17. Iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. Iron is pretty tough. Iron is pretty tough. And if you got iron sharpening iron, that both of them got to be tough. And so if you're in a relationship, you got to have thick skin. I don't know, maybe because I'm the pastor. I don't know, but people sometimes just say stuff to me. I just like, not really. The average person, I knew it would have hurt them. I knew it would offend them. I'll tell you the story. I'm keeping it real far away from here, right? Because this happened years ago. But I remember, I've told this story before, that somebody came up to me and said, man, that hat is too small for your head. but that's not supposed to hurt. I'm styling and profiling, right? Right? So, I had to let it go. I had to just say, okay, I'm not going, because the same person, ended up in the hospital, and I had to go visit him, minister to him, right? So, you got to have thick skin. If you're in a relationship, you got to have thick skin. A lot of people, we would like to think by being around a bunch of God's people, that we're never going to have anything offensive said to us, that there's not going to ever be any wrong thing done. But you need to wake up and come on into the real world. Somebody said to dwell above with those we love, oh, that will be glory. but to live below with those we know. Now, that's quite a different story. And so, you know, we need to realize that offenses are going to make, toughen up. Now, I'm not giving the people who want to run over and bulldoze people, I'm not giving them a license to do that. You know, no. You know, God is going to deal with them. You know, God will deal with them. But people, come on, man. Toughen up a little bit. You know, one thing that I'll say about Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. One thing I will say about both of them, they got thick skin. You know, at the end of the last presidential debate, what they said, can you guys say something nice about each other? You know, they would ask me, what can you say, what nice thing can you say about both of them? I say, y'all both got thick skin. Because, I mean, there's dirt and more dirt and more dirt being brought out. But they just, I mean, you know, yeah, they just keep rolling. How come the Saints, you know, we're so fragile. We need to toughen up. Man, it's going to happen in relationships. But you got to be strong. Got to man up, woman up, buckle up. You know? Or as you got to put on your big boy and big girl Fruit of the Loom. Have thick skin. Have thick skin. Learn how to respond to anger. Proverbs 15:1. A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. So, you know, at some point, going down Penn Avenue yesterday, all right? Traffic is backed up, right? I'm about 10 cars back from the light. There's a lane. This lane right here is the turning lane. The turning lane, right? Somebody went, came to the light when it stopped, and when it turned green, they got in this lane and went. Man, I was ready to take off, pull up behind. Man, come on, man. Then you see everybody else waiting in line, and you just gonna pull up beside everybody and get up, get in front. See? We can get angry before we know it. We can get angry before we know it. And so we need to have the ability to recognize, I'm just leaving the grief ministry concert. Just been worshiping, had a great time, you know, listening to the worshiping God, man, I'm praising God. But just that quick, man, that quick. So, you know, we need to be ready that when something happens that stirs up anger, that we need to have the ability to be able to cool it down. And just not let it get out of control. And so when an angry person comes against us, guess what's going to happen? If we come back with anger, it's just going to escalate. I remember my wife and I think it was last, no, it was year before last. We went to Seven Springs for our wedding anniversary. And we were coming back, right? And it had started snowing. And there was a little snow on the ground, a little icy. And so we're driving down the turnpike. And then all of a sudden, I hear bam in my car. My car starts to skid, and I pull over. And it's this guy, you know, he's driving in this tow truck. And he hit my car. And so he pulled up, and got out, and I got out of my car, and the guy, he was walking, man. He was walking like this. And I said, oh, man, don't let me have to get up in this guy's face, man. I said, so, right, I'm ready, man. You know, man, you hit my car. I'm ready. He comes up, he gets up. Now, he get almost getting to me, right? And I'm getting ready to do one of these numbers. And he said, oh, man, he said, I'm sorry. He said, man, I don't know what happened. The trailer just slipped and hit you. He said, I mean, and just that quick, it was diffused. And that taught me a lesson. And the lesson that it taught me was that if you bring anger against anger, it's just going to make the situation worse. And that's why Proverbs says, a soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir it up. And so we see here is that we need to learn how to respond to our anger. We need to exercise control over our words. Notice what I said in the notes. Oftentimes, look what I put there. That was no mistake. Now, I do make mistakes in these notes, but this is not one. Oftentimes, the relation, what? Ship. Oh, y'all didn't think that was cute? Okay. The relationship is sunk by the torpedoes of words. Come on, man. I put a lot of time into that one. No. All right. Life and death are in the words spoken. Proverbs 18:21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Norman Wright, he says that words are like bullets out of a high-powered rifle. Once you pull the trigger, you can't reach out and bring them back. And so, you know, we need to realize that life and death are in the power of the tongue. That your words can speak life to the relationship, or your words can speak death to the relationship. And you need just that. And once it's out there, you can't get it back. Now, you know, now you can work through the process of forgiveness and restoration. You can work through, but once you put it out there, it's out there. And so you need to realize the power that your words have. You know, you might think that, you know, they don't have a lot of power, but sometimes just the most insignificant and meaningless conversation that you might have, and then you say something, and you don't know how deep that wound went. That's why you got to be careful. You got to really be careful what you say. And, you know, I know I've said stuff, and, you know, again, I know some of my illustrations are old, but I remember when I was out in Colorado, you know, they had a Sunday night service, and we would go to service on Sunday evening, and there was a lady who was playing the piano, and I remember walking in, you know, when she was playing, you know, before the service started, you know, bringing everybody in, and I remember I saw her, and I thought to myself, I said, man, how come she not smiling? And so, you know, I'm going to be the sheriff of the Durango Baptist Temple, the smile sheriff, right? And so I'm going to go up and I'm going to say, you know, you need to smile when you're playing. And I could just see on her face, you know. And I'm like, stupid. Just that quick. Just the words that I said, you know, just affected her countenance immediately. And so be careful with your words in relationships. Words can cut or heal. Proverbs 12:18. There is that speaketh like the piercings of the sword. So some people can speak and it can cut you like a sword. And the tongue of the wise is health. So words can either cut or heal. Gossip can kill a relationship. Gossip can kill a relationship. Proverbs 16:28. A froward man soweth strife, and a whisperer. And that word whisperer actually means gossiper. A gossiper separateth chief friends. Those who are the best of friends, you know, gossip can kill the relationship. And then think about your words before you speak. Proverbs 15:28. The heart of the righteous studies to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. So think about your words. Think about what you're going to say. And just don't let, you know, some people say, well, you know, I just let people know what's on my mind. You know, I just, sometimes you've shown that your mind is not very large. So, you know, think about the words that you're going to speak. And again, now keep in mind, this message was not directed toward husbands, wives, families, you know, all that. It's just in general that these principles in general will help you to be able to function in a relationship. And so the last thing, exercise self-control over your actions. People who are in relationships with others must not only discipline their tongues, they must also discipline their actions. Proverbs 25 and verse 28, he that hath no rule over his spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls. Having rule over one's spirit is to exercise self-control in one's actions. So we are called to control our actions and again to discipline ourselves. So as we think about how to build and maintain healthy relationships, let us keep some of these things in mind. As I close, I want to close with this story that I was reading. Emperor Frederick was an emperor in the Roman Empire in the 13th century. He did a cruel, and not only cruel, but he did a crude experiment. He wanted to know man's original language. He wanted to know if a person was left alone, you know, what would be the language that individual would speak? Because he thought that, you know, it would either be Latin, Greek, or Hebrew. And so he was thinking that, well, what was the original language of Adam and Eve? And so he wanted to know this. And so as he performed this experiment, one of the things that he did is that he isolated infants at birth. And he isolated them from any human voice. He hired nurses to come in and to feed these little babies, to clean them, to hug them and give them the nurturing that they need. But you couldn't make a sound. You couldn't verbalize anything, because the point of the experiment was to see what language these children would automatically speak as they grew up. And as the experiment went on, now again, you can read this, so this is not something I'm making up. I would find it hard to believe if I hadn't read it myself. And that is, after several months, the babies began to die because there was no verbal communication. They began to die. And as I thought about that, I said, isn't that why God, in our very DNA, in our very DNA, God has built us for relationships. You know, when you think about God, you know, God in eternity past, God was just not there all by himself trying to figure out, you know, what to do, waiting for the world to be created. There was the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And they had intense fellowship. And we are created in the image of God. And so we are designed for relationship. And that being the case, isn't it a wonderful God that would say, I realize that there's going to be some problems in relationships, and so I'm going to give you a word. And that this word is going to help you to be able to work through the relationship problems that you have. And so, a burning question on the heart of people: how do I build and maintain healthy relationships. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to share the word of God this morning into this afternoon. And Lord, we ask now that you would speak to the hearts of your people. And Lord, help us to realize that you have called us to relationship. You have designed us for relationship. And Lord, even as we read about this experiment that was done with these babies and how that there was no verbal communication, how that the babies began to die. And Lord, let us realize the importance of community. Let us realize that in community there's going to be offenses that come. But Lord, help us to realize that you have given us ways to work through it so that in the end, you would be glorified. Father, I pray today that if there's someone here that has never received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, that they might come and one of our counselors would open up the Word of God and show them what it means to become a child of God. If there's someone here today that's looking for a church home, this is the place where you have led them. Father, we pray that they would come as we give the invitation today. We commit it to you now in Christ's name. Amen.